Manny.
Hello.
Manny, we're back. We're back. It's been a week, right? Just a week, I think. Is that right?
Yeah, just 6 days since we happen every week.
Just the 1 week. I'm pretty sure it's only been a week because we do the podcast every week.
Without fail.
Yeah, there's no weeks that we don't do it. And there's no chance of that ever happening where we'd only do it once.
Yeah.
Once a month. That would not be a thing that could happen. Well, it's Hugh Ferrari 18, Manny. I am wearing my defunct long sleeve. Get the mic out of the way. Get the mic out of the way.
This guy, what a shitty shill. The funny thing is, I'm wearing my defunct merch as well, but it is...
It's very
currently
good.
Occupied by a
puppet
sausage.
That's fine. Yes. You know, that's a good, as far as things go, that could be in the way. That's pretty good. Manny, we got the build. Oh, man. You know what? It's weird. We have a lot to talk about.
I mean, one of the best things about doing a pod on the sixth day versus the seventh day of a regular week, which is when we shoot this pod, is that 6 days of content you've had to build up.
Yeah.
Only 6 days.
Yeah, otherwise no days. Because on a Sunday, it's the first day of the week, so I have no content. We have to talk about the future week, right?
Exactly. Yeah. You understand.
Yeah, that's how it works. So we got release notes. They called it like a pre-release or like a draft version, something kind of weird, right?
Because I'm guessing they weren't including like new content names and stuff like that.
Fuck this up. One fucking job.
So we got release notes, but it's kind of like a draft. So we'll see what's up. And then we have an RTP talk from Vegas. What?
Is that someone logging into our private server?
Is this? No, it's password protected.
No, it's I put the password on before we got in.
No one can get in without a password. No one can get in the servers without passwords.
Give me your podcast
info. No.
I mean, the setups. Give me everything.
Ban him.
Financials. It's all mine.
Hey, Brian.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going pretty
Lockwood
good.
Lockwood in his house. Tom, as usual, you have totally fucked OBS only you can.
It was Brian. I wasn't expecting him to bust in here.
Now these poor people have no puppy cam, only you cam,
I know.
And no Brian cam. What the fuck is the point?
Do we have a Brian cam?
We're trying to have a Brian cam. It's
okay.
Trying.
Okay.
Trying being the operating room.
Okay.
I made sure to bring you puppy content today, Brian. So congratulations!
Oh, I love it.
Once we get Brian cam, I think. Hey. We did it.
I guess this is factual. I'm not Foster, and Brian also has black hair, so I mean it checks out. I see no reason to fix it.
Oh no! Let me just. It's always just a cluster around here, isn't it?
Yes.
I tell you what. He's only here for Manny Pasta. Yeah, well, join the club, okay? What do you want from me?
I mean, this guy. I guess the only reason we have you in charge of OBS is probably because I'm too lazy to do it, but it is what it is.
Hey, you know what? When you're getting people busting into your
private servers,
it's a little bit trickier, you know? I think you're underestimating how difficult this is. Anyway. Oh, my God. Let's see here.
I have a sleepy boy.
Okay. We were just talking about what we're going to talk about. We got release notes, and I said they got the patch, or they called it the draft version. We got RTP. We got BMW 120 tomorrow. We got the Coke race that happened from Vegas. This show is called Making Bets and Stealing Sets, because we've been betting in Vegas and... people have been stealing sets. Oh, my God.
So much content, so little time.
What do you guys want to start with?
Do we start with, I guess, I feel like we should ramp up to, like, big hype. So what is the least hype thing we have to talk about?
the least hype.
Your RTP finishes?
I think it was BMW 120 tomorrow is probably the least hype.
No, those would be mine. Mine, actually.
Brian, what do you? You're the guest here. You're the unwelcome guest, the unexpected. Oh. Probably right. You may choose what we'd like to start with.
True. I mean, I have all the data, right?
You should data. Just hit garage. It should be there.
Mm-hmm. All right.
You look at shared sets or something. Whatever. What I don't know. I don't know how they were doing it. However, they're hacking.
Well, I think we start with.
Did we invite them on the pod next week?
Oh my god. No way they'd come.
I don't know. Depends on your definition of hype. Let's go with the BMW first, since that's what we just hop off of practice for.
Okay. So we got BMW 120 at Suzuka, Brian. Mm-hmm. This is a little bit different, though, because we
great
don't...
Great track.
Do you like best the combo, track. Brian?
Well, sort of. I didn't expect to. I don't usually like Suzuka. And
what the fuck?
Car feels weird. I'm just not good at it. If I'm not good at it, I don't like it.
The GTE always feels, the BMWs always kind of hit or miss for me. Oh, before we jump into this, tell me if this is the most Wisconsin thing you've heard. I have Urge Tracker, peanut butter cup flavored milk stout. Okay. But Urge Tracker is a type of ice cream sold at Quick Trip convenience stores. Okay. And this is a Quick Trip beer. What do you think?
Is this more of that peanut butter shit?
Yeah, yeah. See, there's the quick series God. Right there. See, it's a Quick Trip beer.
I feel like when I'm evaluating beer prospects, convenience store branded beer is not going to be the one I choose.
No. Well,
I mean, on the way down, there's still Busch, there's still Coors Light, there's still Bud Light.
So this was a...
So those are three like passable choices before I hit convenience store brand.
Well, it's a Carbon 4 brewing company, but they did it for the Quick Trip as like a little collab. Except, come on, it's good. It's quite good. Thank you, proletariat. Thank you.
I mean, experimenting with like peanut butter beers. Especially, I wouldn't go.
I'm
with
not
the
experimenting.
Brand.
I'm not experimenting, and it's very good.
You never know if it's going to be any good. Like, no. At least regular beer is regular beer. Harder to screw that up.
Tell me about Suzuka. I'm tired of your. Oh no, Manny, that's so toxic. You deleted him.
No, I timed him out. Okay. There will be no guests. Gas station endorsements for beer while I'm in here.
Manny will absolutely crush you if you say anything good about me in the chat, just so you know.
I might allow it as long as it's not anything good about peanut butter beer, like anything else.
What's wrong with you? You're,
I can roll with it.
You're just the worst. So Suzuka, I think, is good. I did want to say it's pretty different than Daytona because we don't have such a huge fuel save meta, right?
Wait. Suzuka's different from Daytona?
Who'd have thought?
Well, I mean, at Daytona, it was you needed three extra laps or something going full out, which is like a pretty substantial amount of fuel. But we don't need that at Suzuka. I think that's pretty different, right? Yeah. That's pretty different.
Daytona and Le Mans, when they ran it, they were two very different races than the usual. I mean, pace was relevant, but it was pace while fuel saving.
Yep.
Suzuka and most of the other more technical tracks tend to be more just who's better, who's faster.
See, I kind of enjoy the 120 meta with the Daytona. It was fun.
I thought
to watch.
It was awesome. I'll be honest. I thought it was really cool. But it did. Well, I think what I like about it is that you have more unpredictable things later in the race than a normal sim race, because we don't have cautions, but we do now have, like, we don't know how long everyone's pit stop is going to be and when they're going to pit. So I felt like I was more, when I watched it back, I felt like I was more interested in what was happening even an hour in, you know, which you watch a PESC race and, you know, who's at the front, right? And just send them. They're done. They're gone.
I mean,
Brian wasn't amused.
With this with the pest cars being so draft heavy this year, I think chaos can happen at any time.
No,
especially last few laps.
I'm mostly memeing. They actually the pest race has been really good. I'm sorry, Brian.
You better be.
I'm sorry.
They're about to be even better after Tuesday, but we'll get into that after.
Ooh, so spicy. Those release notes. We're going to talk through them. I'm going to really read them line by line.
Okay.
No, I'm not.
I'm not opposed to that. I haven't been on the computer at all, so I haven't seen them or anything.
Brian,
I only know that what was posted on the server.
So you're driving with Kane Halliburton tomorrow. What's the ideal finish? What's the likely finish? What are you targeting here for a position? If that is something position based goal, I don't know.
Yeah, you know, we actually talked about it a couple days ago, just what we're expecting from the race. And basically, we want like a, you know, top 20, top 15 would be great. That's not what we're aiming for long term, of course, but for this race, just getting warmed up. The big thing is just learning a bit more of the car. You know, we haven't driven this since V7 came out like over a year ago. So kind of just getting warmed up, getting a feel for it, and having a good platform to build off of for the next three races.
Yeah, and it is pretty different with the season because we go GTE for the first half, and then we're moving to the BMW GT3 for the second half of the BMW 120 season, which would be kind of interesting and mix things up. I think so. Last time we did the 120, I actually thought we were in a little bit worse pace. Myself and my teammate were a little bit worse off on pace, but I think there was a lot of attrition and the field was pretty spread out at Daytona, and we finished 26th, I think. Does that sound right, Manny? 26th, 25th, somewhere in there.
It might have been as high as 22nd, because I feel like there were a lot of last lap shenanigans.
Sure. Either way, I do think Suzuka will be a little bit different kind of a game, even if we're better off on pace. So, but, you know, even finishing top half would be a win, and we'll probably take some attrition. But, hey, I don't know, send the car and see what happens. And enjoy the field. It's always fun racing in a fast field, though, I got to say. It's always a good time, regardless. Usually.
Brief side note. Brian, what are you drinking today?
I'm not drinking anything. I got a race tomorrow morning, Manny.
You're one with the Lord today. I love it.
Well, Brian's not going to sleep, so that's why he can't drink any alcohol right now.
Ooh, smart.
Because he'll never sleep it off.
That's not really a thing, is it?
I don't know.
Sleeping it off? I don't think it's a thing.
Well, sleeping for you isn't a thing, if that's what you meant.
That is also not a thing, but I mean, you know, the hangover, if there is one, it takes the same process whether you're sleeping or not, right?
I would assume so.
Yeah.
But at least a chunk
of
it.
As someone
happens,
with experience, I would think so.
Yeah, I'll leave that to the experts.
Anyway, BMW 120. There's a half an hour practice beforehand, right, Brian? After Reg, so the broadcast probably starts at 7:30 Central.
Yeah, I think so.
Broadcast 7:30 Central, 8:30 Eastern Time in the morning.
I'll probably be asleep, but best of luck, boys.
Thank you, Manny.
Thank you.
But yeah, the broadcast race pod. Dealio on BMW Motorsport, YouTube, and such. That's fun. Anyway, next. Manny, your pick. Spin the wheel.
Let's do build next.
Oh, the build. Okay, let me bring up the draft. Okay, anyone, did you guys read this yet? Read the draft? Read the release notes? Anybody?
Mm-mm.
No?
I've seen the relevant clipping.
Okay. Pre-release draft.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Pre-release draft is what it says. Okay. Here are the highlights. Okay. Super late model. Updated. Fresh.
It looked pretty good.
I thought it was super late,
but it looked good.
Well, when Brian goes full oval, Billy, he'll be doing all kinds of short track stuff and everything. So
I'm excited to race Silver Crowns with Brian. It's going to be great.
Yeah, when
not happening.
When, you know,
NASCAR bust.
3 years from now, Manny, when Brian's strictly an oval league racer on Tuesday and Thursday nights, racing, he'll be racing the Silver Crown car and the ARCA in an open full length series of the mimicking the 2006 NASCAR Cup Series. Yeah, you get to race him whenever, you know, it'll be great. So.
That was still a Nextel year, wasn't it? That was probably a decent year if it was Nextel.
2006. Yeah.
Might be Nextel still at that point.
Would it have still been the ARCA car, the ARCA body style at that point? Or would they have been done? I know.
ARCA.
That Gen 4?
No. Because.
Help in the chat. Please help. Yeah. Kev, yeah. Help me. Okay, we got through one item and we've already been sidetracked. Barcelona Rallycross. Pretty fun.
Super fucking stoked for that. Yeah. That's going to be
very,
so fun.
Very
if
awesome.
You've never seen that track, it is so cool.
Were there a couple really cool ones added this season as well?
Yeah, Brands Hatch.
And Charlotte.
Brands Hatch is legendary. Brands Hatch Rallycross is the first rallycross track I ever did in my life on Toka 3 when I was in like seventh or eighth grade.
Wait, Brian, you haven't driven Brands?
No, not yet.
Oh, dude,
oh,
it's really fun.
Yeah?
It's really hard, really tricky, good. But it's really good. Really good.
Cool.
What
it's
else?
Like it's kind of like an indie with a twist, maybe the best way to describe it.
Indie with a twist. Like, you know, indie. The Brands Indie.
Yeah, Brands Indie.
Oh.
Yeah, actually, that's a good description.
Sounds fun.
It's actually excellent. Sorry, Bark River International Raceway. This is a dirt road, right? This is in the UP, is that right?
Yeah, UP. I have to say, loving the last, I don't know, three builds of, like, adding significant dirt road content. It's big. I love it. I'm here for it.
Here for dirt road content.
I'm almost 4K dirt road. It's the first and maybe only one I'll break 4K in, so hell yeah.
Just when they have a dirt truck thing at Pro 2. What's the Pro 2 the top? Pro 4. I never remember.
Pro 2 is the top, technically.
When they have a
Pro 4s are faster, but Pro 2 is much harder to drive. So I guess
doesn't
it's kind of like
sense.
The difference between the B and A car. So Pro 4 would be top, but it's easier. And then Pro 2 would be like the Xfinity equivalent, probably.
What's the big Crandon race? Twos?
Everything.
But what's like the top class? Is there a top class?
Oh, Pro 4s, yeah.
Pro 4s, okay. So when they have a Pro 4 World Championship, Manny, you're ready.
Oh, I'm there. I am all... Honesty, if there is ever like a world championship I'll go full sweat for, it would be Dirt Truck World Championship. I would be all over that.
That might be a good show, I'll be honest. That might be a good show.
I mean, you've seen me race it on stream. I'm not horrible at it.
It'd be like Rallycross, but you could get away with more hitting. That'd be good.
Have you guys ever run the pro trucks on a road course, just messing around?
Yeah, I've done, I think it was Pro 2s at Belle Isle. Hectic. Mm-hmm. Really fun.
Yep. That's honestly some of the most fun I've ever had driving on iRacing.
Wow.
If they made it, and honestly, the racing is great. As you said, Dom, you can bump around. Yeah, that'd be super fun. I'd watch it.
I think I would too. That'd be good. I ran Pro 2 at Nord, say, in a community race.
Oh, that's right. Zach did that, right?
What was the time?
Yeah, that was one of Zach's.
Here for TR. By the way, that was me reading the chat. I did not do that because I don't hate myself. For the audio-only listeners, time was DNF as always. Good choice for everyone. Sounds about right. It sounds like an interesting...
Honestly, the Pro 2 would be really hard to wheel around Nords. That would not be fun. And like, you would enjoy it, but the odds of your survival are not high.
Sure, yeah.
Okay. Okay, continuing on. It's three items we made it through now.
We're doing great.
Yeah, we're doing fine.
So good.
We're doing fine. Bristol Motor Speedway Dirt. Oh, yes.
Hot. I don't think I'll care about it in anything it'll be running. Like, I probably won't race A, B, or C on Bristol Dirt because I'm trash at Dirt Oval. And there's just something about it that I don't get it. It ain't happening. There's only one Dirt Oval car I can occasionally drive.
Kev says, Manny out here playing hot or
yeah.
not.
Yeah, Bristol Dirt is like oatmeal that's been out for half an hour hot.
Okay, let's
there's some warmth.
I want a
Brian
Lockwood hot or not. Super late model update.
Don't care.
So not. Brian, you say not. You know how
sure.
this game works?
No, I mean that's not fair because you know, I'm sure it's really cool to the people who are into it.
But you are, I thought the community was built around all the world championship drivers. So
yikes.
Well, Dirt has a world championship.
Okay, fine. We're playing hot or not or Manny.
You can say hot, lukewarm or not. I don't know.
Lukewarm. There you go.
Sure. Sure.
And Barcelona Rallycross, was that hot?
Hot.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, sure. That's hot.
That didn't seem that hot, Brian. Bark River?
Brian struggles with
Bark
his emotions.
River? Bark River?
Bark River hot.
Brian?
Lukewarm.
Lukewarm, okay.
Shut the fuck up, Brian.
Bristol Dirt? Bristol Dirt, Brian?
Not, because I'll probably have to race it at some point.
Yeah, that's hilarious.
That's a good point.
At all.
I'm lukewarm on that one.
I am as well. I'm really happy it's in the sim, but am I looking forward to racing it?
Yeah, you just talk shit on Broletariat's house. How does that make you feel?
I hope you feel bad, Brian. He feels bad. Okay,
he's searching for the ejecto seat button.
Hockenheim.
I'm sorry, Travis. I really don't.
Hockenheim. Hot.
Hockenheim hot.
Hot, yeah.
Yeah, hot.
Hot. Everyone loves it. Okay.
I don't really like it for open wheel racing. I don't know. It might be funner in the smaller formulas. I've never done Hockenheim in a smaller formula car. But the GT racing at Hockenheim is usually...
Really? He's chef kissing for the audio-only listeners. The audio-only listeners are loving it, by the way.
If you've never watched like GT Masters or something at Hockenheim, I would highly recommend it, Brian. It is a good time.
When you started that sentence, I thought you were going to say, if you've never seen me chef's kiss, you should really be watching on Twitch. Okay, Manny doesn't like it. Sonoma Raceway IndyCar 2012-2018 version layout.
Don't we already have that?
No, they took out like some hairpin or something.
Wait, what? I have no idea.
I'm going with not because it's like it's
yeah,
not
that's
comparing.
Not. It's not.
If I was in IndyCar, sorry.
I wish they'd remove the bus stop and boot layout of Watkins Glen. That's
just remove it. Just remove it. Not use it. You're just saying like have it not exist. That's what you're
yeah.
saying.
Similar to how Sonoma just happened to add a layout. I think that layout should be deleted from Watkins.
Wow, that's really toxic.
It's a take.
Taylor is 100% correct. Just what we needed. Another random Sonoma layout to learn. Yeah, pass. Also, fun fact, Sonoma isn't actually a desert. If you watch the GT World Challenge race today, it's very green.
I have heard that, yeah.
Really?
It's the same with Laguna. Laguna isn't actually a desert.
It's not that green, at least not when I went.
No, it's not like super, super green, but it's not like in the middle of like the Sierra Nevada the way that, you know, playing it on a video game usually would make you feel.
Sure. What's interesting about that track is the green, like, curbing area, super vivid. Like, way more green than anything green around it.
Checks out.
Fun fact.
So we're not happy with slightly different layouts. Got it. I understand. Okay, paint shop overhaul.
Slightly different layouts are fine. As a brief aside, Brian, since you've been to Laguna in person, how good is the Corkscrew in person. I heard that there's never been a game really to do justice to how freaking steep it is.
It felt the same as in iRacing. I mean, obviously there's the drop, right? And
iRacing 1-to-1 confirmed.
You don't physically feel that in any sim. But the way you drive it's the same. You know? And that's kind of that's what I'm relating everything to. If I can drive it the same, if I know what to expect, then it's just kind of what I expect.
All right.
It is really steep looking at it though. Kind of like when you go to Daytona, the banking seems really banked really high when you first see it in person. Same thing at Laguna. It is a pretty serious drop.
Sure. Well, okay. We're still clicking on. Good job, boys. Talking about Sonoma. We're not happy about a weird layout. Understood. More options for the IndyCar. Not bad, but we all say not hot. Okay, paint shop overhaul. Do I need to tell you what this is, or do you just want to go for it? Okay.
You should still describe it, but it sounds hot.
A new design maximizes the available screen space using the full width of the UI. Okay. 3D model viewer had been fully integrated in the paint shop. You can directly manipulate your view of the model as you work. That's nice. You don't have to go back and forth. Full helmet soup driver customization in the paint shop. Car model option to organized. Paint swatch and color pick have been improved. You can copy paste, organize your schemes. Driver characters are now fully animated in the 3D model viewer.
Okay.
Super hot.
Super hot. Like lava.
Yeah, that's pretty hot. That's pretty hot. Good job, iRacing. Stock car dirt tires. Do we care? Do we like this?
No.
I feel like it should be classed the same as Bristol dirt. Like, it wouldn't be fair really to class it above or below it. So I'll go with lukewarm again.
I'm going to go lukewarm because it does open options for more people than just degenerates.
And stock car tires, hopefully that includes improvements to how the trucks feel at Eldora, which is something that already existed on the sim. So hopefully an improvement on that front.
True.
Kev says, in sim, it'll be a shit show. IRL, it's 50-50 shit show or not. I would argue that IRL, a shit show will be equally as entertaining as not. In the sim, you do not want a shit show, though. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, checks out.
Okay. Like, if the race is just horrible, like, if it's just absolutely bonkers in real life, like, it's still good. Right? Okay. Smoke and dust volumetric and lighting updates. Pour on the heat. Yes?
I'm saying hot, but in terms of my CPU and GPU temps, not...
Oh, definitely hot.
Brian's...
Yeah, super hot.
Brian's very
for me. It's no. I mean your CPU and GPU temps. Lukewarm. I'm never gonna use it.
Yeah, when you mentioned that, I just heard my poor GTX 1080 cry.
You know,
and now I can't stream anymore.
Kev says,
thanks to everyone who subbed to my stream, which is sometimes not horrible, but I'm not gonna be able to stream anymore. Rip.
Rip.
I'm laughing in 3080 and less than 144
frames. Piss off. Kev says, my computer can't run 7 cars. How am I supposed to manage new volumetric smoke? Ha ha, Kevin. But let me tell you a story. Back when, not that long ago, when I had potato PC, I couldn't run spot 24 because my computer couldn't do it. You think this is a joke?
That's actually true. I do remember that. I had a good laugh at it. I remember having a laugh at it.
Oh, yeah. Buy a better PC, Tom. Well, I did. But still, I still feel for my boys with the Spud PCs.
Oh, I've been pricing out new PCs. It ain't cute right now,
peace,
let me tell you.
Homies.
No.
Okay, replay audio processing, compression, and distortion DSP effects.
Might be hot.
I mean, I'm kind of lukewarm, but it could be.
When I think about like consuming replays in general, like that's kind of nice, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not bad. A new pace car, the most important thing on the release notes.
Hot.
We don't know what it is. I wonder if I can. I wonder if
doesn't matter.
What it is.
The old ones are just unplayable.
Oh, guys, get ready. Get ready for this. I got it. New pace
car.
Is
it a Corvette?
It's a sedan style vehicle, not manufactured by any of the known names and cars. Our secretly created sedan provides no brand favoritism, while maintaining a stylish and professional look on the track.
It's definitely a Mercedes E-Class.
It is now the default pace car for oval asphalt events.
Wow.
What do you think about that?
I'm not sure how to feel about that, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it's sort of unusual.
Yes, an asexual amorphic blog. That is the perfect description.
Bilitarius says, a.k.a. no one would pay iRacing to use their car.
You know what would be fun? If iRacing just animated some dude running super, super fast, and we all had to stay behind the dude as the pace car.
I would be very down with that, yeah. Especially if he had like flashing yellow lights. That'd be great.
Yeah. Maybe someone on a bicycle would be more realistic. Tom, you know about that, right?
Yeah, I mean, they can go 20, 30 miles an hour, yeah.
Yeah, they can go 60, 70 miles an hour, no problem.
I've gone 46 miles an hour on a bicycle, but only downhill.
That sounds terrifying, I'll be honest.
It does.
The state championship road race.
The state world championship?
Oh, my God. Okay, the pace car thing, though? Well, you know, we're making up race cars. Let's make up pace cars too, right? We'll make up anything we want. IR01, sedans, whatever. Okay, a new damage model for the IR01, Renault 2.0, the 87 NASCARs, and the street stock.
Brief aside on the Renault 2.0. I wasn't expecting that series to like stay popular with all the other cars on the service, but it's kept a dedicated community, and that kind of makes me happy because that car is pretty fun. I rate this update a hot.
Hot.
Also, our IR01, never heard of it.
Okay.
That's Brian's problem, not mine.
We got new tires. Okay. Do you want all the cars listed off new tires? Do you need it?
Yeah. Fuck it. Why not?
Okay. the Aston GT1, the Audi GTO, BMW GT4, Corvette GT1, Ford GT2, Indy Pro, Porsche GT4, supercars, both of them, USF 2000, the Legacy Riley, Legacy Supercars, Legacy Supercars.
So basically all the holdouts, all the cars that really needed new tires.
Well, no, GT1's been on V7 for like two seasons now.
That's true.
They were like the first GT guinea pig.
Kevin, how dare you imply that the GT4 is legacy, quote unquote? That is messed up. TaylorMade, don't worry. We're just doing the cliff notes, and then after the show, I'll make Manny read the thing word for word, so you can just stay on after.
Yeah, but at least then, Taylor, it'll be good. So yeah,
that's right. That's right. Okay, last. The M4 GT4 should be
content. I do think the M4 GT4 should be free content.
Yeah, free. Free. Delete M4 GT4 when they delete Watkins Glen Boot.
This guy fucks 100%.
Man, the viewership is getting more and more toxic every episode. Okay. AI.
You were worried about the announcers being toxic. It's not the announcers that you need to worry about, Chief.
It's out of control. The AI racing content added. We got the GT3 cars.
Brief aside, Kevin says he has even hotter takes. Let's fucking go. I love this.
Okay, I'm waiting. Kevin?
You promised me hot content. Deliver the goods.
God, will you fuck this up?
I
probably do have hotter takes hidden somewhere.
When you take
GT3 AI, very hot, two, right? Like super duper hot.
Okay, GT3
super lukewarm, like precisely room temperature down to like 3 decibels.
I'll be honest with you. I don't think the AI is very
good. On the off chance it teaches even one person to drive with cars around them in VRS, that will already be an improvement.
Waiting for viewers to make up content in chat. What is this shit? That's just the show, man. What do you want from me? Yeah, I don't.
Have you not seen the shows where Shane comes in chat and just runs our show for us?
No, I have not seen the AI driver programs, Kev. Brian.
Also, brief aside, friend of the pod, Shane. Hope he's healing well. Big whack this morning. Yeah,
big cool. Collarbone damage. Brian, guess what track got into the AI list?
Give us what now?
Guess what track got added to the AI list?
Guess what?
Oh, this track. Is good. This is good.
Come on.
I don't know.
Vegas, what? Brian. Vegas. Wouldn't that have been nice?
Real nice.
Brian's face is like the magnitude of this soaks in. Oh, it was good content.
1 week away. Atlanta's on there, though. Don't worry.
Yeah, they basically looked at the RTP guys and went, dear RTP, get fucked.
So there's not much else. That was the main bits. I do want to point out a couple things about that all the GT3 cars got quote-unquote toe adjustment increments and limits have been updated, which I think this means, has been hinted at in some Discord.
No meme toe docs anymore.
Means no negative toe like the Porsche Cup. I do think that's what that means.
Ridiculous.
And
the AI got new training as well. I've never used the AI. I've heard it's okay, but if they've been retrained, I'm a little concerned about who they've been retrained by, but I guess time will tell. And it doesn't affect me at all, so have at it.
GT4 got the same thing with the rear toe, positive only. Also, the GT4 does read differently about the toe. It says positive only, where the GT3 just says toe limits updated. So we could see something that might be limited at, like, possibly a little bit negative. Anyway, that's something that myself and Brian were actually just talking about. Is it a good thing to limit the... I know we talked about this before on the pod. Is it a good thing to limit the sets to encourage more realistic setups?
Yeah, I think so. Like, if real life... well, I guess let me figure out how I phrase this carefully. If there are certain limitations two sets that are universal across every series that runs a car, then yeah, sure, let's introduce those limits.
Well,
here as
no,
well.
No, it's not a limit in the real series, it's just something
a
to
thing
encourage
you don't do?
Us. Yes, exactly.
Oh, so, no, fuck that.
Exactly,
no.
Okay, yes, that's...
All right, we're all on the same page.
So here's the thing, right? I think that a lot of times we as sim racers who are not engineers occasionally probably do things that are not the best thing to make our car go fast. Right? Probably happens all the time.
I just hold it flat.
However, do we need to be limited to not make the dumb thing?
If the dumb thing works, then I guess it wasn't that dumb, was it?
I mean, that's another argument. Do we have something happening in the sim physics that isn't quite what it should be? That's the other question, you know. So
I really don't think it makes sense to limit just to make the setups more realistic, because, you know, I don't think it's particularly realistic to be running zero rear toe as just a standard, you know, you never want more than zero toe. I don't think it's very realistic to always be running minimum pressures, but we are.
Well, so, you know, in Formula One, they pretty much always run minimum pressures. I don't know if you knew that.
I did not.
I do believe at a lot of tracks they run.
Yeah,
they have a minimum.
Correct, yeah.
They have a minimum that Pirelli says that you have to.
And from the conversation we had with Senor David Pirell way back in the day, it sounds like the limits that are introduced for the tire are more durability related, but not necessarily like hard limits on what your minimum pressure
should be. He said that theoretically, like, lower might be even better, but the tire would blow up.
Yeah,
basically what he said. And we can't make our tires die.
Yeah, so minimum allowable is, it seems like it checks out, kind of.
Yeah, yeah. We're sort of a weird thing.
And, you know, I think it's a little bit, it doesn't quite add up with iRacing's whole approach to the tire model, which I really have a lot of respect for what they're trying to do. They're trying to build the tire from the ground up so that the rubber is properly simulated. And the effect of the rubber and the track interacting creates realistic numbers in the tire.
Right, right.
Yeah.
But it's not perfect. And anybody who's done
ACC
10 minutes of research, well, sure, I mean, ACC might feel better in some ways, but anybody who's done 10 minutes of research into how iRacing does their tires knows why it's not perfect, knows it's an incremental process. And I think we're in a pretty good place right now. You know, there's still work to be done, but it's a serviceable tire. And to just say we can't do certain things because they work with this tire model and not in real life, I mean, I don't know, isn't that just kind of sweeping the reality under the rug? And not only sweeping it under the rug, just own it. Like, yeah, our tires aren't perfect. Here's why. It's because we're doing something different and better than anybody else. Why are we moving away from that?
That's actually really well reasoned, I think. Yeah, I there's nothing bad I have to say about how you've raised that.
Do you think, and I, particularly in the Porsche Cup, I know you and I have talked about this before, Brian, I do think that the negative toe is the best in the Cup to a certain limit. Of course, like, you can't just point the tires out sideways, but there's a limit that, like, negative toe is better than, like, a mill in or something. Mm-hmm. And we kind of see similar things in GT3, right? At least feeling, you know, I'm no engineer, so, like, we only know so much about what's happening with the cars. But it does seem that a lot of times a tiny bit of negative toe can help free up the rear.
Right.
However, Christian Chalner has said that he thinks that it's more of a meta thing and people not knowing how to adjust other parts of the car to make a positive toe work. I'm not saying that I necessarily always agree with him, and I don't for the Porsche Cup for sure. And another number of other cars I've ran negative toe in the rear and preferred it and ran it. But I do think that it is possible to have a meta that actually encourages us to do something that is not good. On occasion, I'm less sure about the toe thing, and I'm less sure if this is a good idea. But it's probably happened that we've done this before. We've done, like, a weird thing that was actually bad for our cars, even at high split. Is that reasonable, Brian? I don't know.
I think,
like, 100% tape and quali, because you know you can blow the engine with no consequence.
No, it's more like everyone ran no wing because two teams tried it and they went faster immediately, even though actually a higher wing would be better if we did something with the car. But no one figured it out. So everyone ran minimum wing all of a sudden.
Right.
I mean, I think to some extent it's possible, but not to such a large extent, I don't think.
Okay.
Just because the goal of a setup, this car's setup and the driver have to work in tandem to keep the tires at the limit for as much of the corner as possible, right? Mm-hmm. And a setup that's faster, theoretically, is better able to do that. Now, if it's not fundamentally correct, if there are balance issues working against each other, sure, it might not be the most optimal thing, but if one direction was clearly faster, it's hard for me. Hard for me to just hand wave that as, oh, it's just something fast guys did. And I can totally see a situation where nobody knows what's going on. A couple fast guys do a certain thing and everybody else follows. But that's a sort of meta change that works itself out over time. if it's something consistent that we see over a long period on the same model, I don't know about that.
All right. I mean, I guess it depends on how much we assume the tire really works compared to reality. And I think it's completely okay and probably expected that we don't have a perfect model because it's a game. But I know we're trying. But I agree. Yeah, and I'm not certain about the change. Personally, actually, you know, here's what I'll say. Ethically, I don't like it. I don't think we should have it. Personally, I love it. I hate negative rear toe. I know it's faster, but I hate driving it. So, like, this just me being like, okay, that's one less thing I have to deal with and mess with. I actually do like it. So,
oh my God.
Sorry.
I'm so disappointed, though.
But like I said, I don't want it. I don't want it. Please take it back. However, thank you personally. I'm happy to see that for my GT3 efforts. Okay, before we get too much, Proletariat said it's sim racing, not sim engineering goals. I think realistic racing, not realistic setups. Agreed. Hopefully those two things can go hand in hand, but it is a very complex problem.
Sauce.
He also said, FFB change is interesting. Seems to say that iRacing way to evaluate FFB signal strength before sending it to your device. I think it's more in very specific situations that if it detects an extreme change of force, like if you get in a crash, it will cut force to your wheel to try to not break your fingers.
Oh, that's nice.
So it's probably to pull down the DD injury rate, I imagine.
Yeah, I mean, I bet every direct drive user has had a moment where they're like, whoa. That almost actually injured my hand.
Yeah, so it's a new force limiter has been implemented that reduces force feedback in a strong vehicle crash or other extreme force event occurs. This is now enabled by default, and basically it's just tries to protect you from your wheel when it generates a bunch of force all at once. So that's what I see. That's all I see in the release notes. Tell me if I'm missing anything, but seems like a good idea. Doesn't seem like I can't imagine a situation where that would be bad, I guess. But
likewise, I think that's probably for the best.
I think that's about it. Oh, the last thing I said, they did mention that a couple of track surfaces have been adjusted, and it says... Track surface dynamics has been updated to react more realistically with tires of different compounds. But if you notice that all the tracks that NASCAR is going forward to in the near future have this update. So, dynamic track.
Oh, that sucks, Taylor. Poor Dalty.
Yeah, in the chat, Dalty just missed the 12 hour from a wrist injury on the DD. Yeah.
I'm pretty happy with my 2.5. Like, I've got it dialed in pretty good. I think the only upgrade I really care about equipment-wise right now is having a better frame so I can swap the pedals and then maybe looking at a better screen solution. But other than that, like...
The only upgrade is, like, 4 upgrades.
I mean, you get what I mean, though. Like, I don't think that for me and how I use the sim and how much I'm able to get out of it as is, that a DD is necessarily like the answer that I need right now. So I'd rather prioritize other things first.
Oh, guys, I found something in the release notes. It's very good. Are you ready?
Oh boy.
Are you ready, Brian? Spectators. An option for spectators to be able to access the in-sim start and stop spotting user interface has been added. This allows spectators to view the live extrapolated car positions in case they are spotting for a team that does not make them a team member. This might happen if a team does not want the potential spotter to see their car set up. I wonder why they put this in here. Oh, dear.
Sauce.
I'm sure. Nothing to do with recent events.
Oh, no.
Did we cover the GT3 cup and quality updates?
GT3 cup and quality updates.
I don't think we've talked about Porsche cup or quality updates yet.
I don't. We don't really know what it is.
We know the verbiage they use to describe it.
We do.
Would you like to read it for the class?
Brian, in the cup car, the anti-stall clutch has been removed and rear collision parameters have been improved to stop cars from submarining each other.
Oh, that's great.
So, yeah, that was it, though.
There's still one more thing.
Yes, Kev, we did see the IMSA LED panel, but I didn't see that. Taylor, we will get to that in a moment. Man, see, Taylor's like, oh, man, you guys are reading it line by line. And he's like, oh, talk about it line by line. Tell me about the GT3 fix. Come on, buddy. Okay, Manny, go ahead.
No, wasn't there an additional line about qualifying scrutiny being adjusted?
Yes, there was.
You want to talk about
says,
that?
It says, let me read it. It says, some additional adjustments have been made for the qualification conduct scrutiny system, particularly concerning braking, pit speeds, and optimal race line speeds. These adjustments will be more noticeable at higher levels of scrutiny. Brian's mouthing, thank you.
That sound you heard, I mean, this is like... How hot would you rate this, Brian? Like, what's the hottest rating on your
fucking
scale?
Supernova? Right, yeah. In the middle.
Do you think they really? You think they'll actually? It'll end the brake dragging?
Absolutely not.
Yeah, that's kind of what I thought too. But
no, they'll just figure out how to adjust their behavior.
It'll reduce it though.
Oh, reducing's good. Reducing's good.
Yeah.
Gone is better, but reducing's good.
There is a if you reduce it enough. Doesn't really do anything.
Yeah.
So
right.
I'm hoping we get to that point.
Maybe
it sounds like they're taking serious steps in that direction. So hopefully, Brian, top 10 pesk at the end of the season.
We'll
I don't
see.
Know.
I'll just be happy not to be starting P36.
Mm. Yeah.
P38.
Be a nice
change. Taylor.
I made a really good 36 joke at some point this week,
no.
And Brian enjoyed it a lot. It took him a second, but when it clicked, is it fair to call that joke of the week, Brian?
This fucking guy. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Oh wow. Okay. Didn't think he was gonna agree there. GT3 fixed sprint series next season. Hot or not?
Very hot, actually. I think that's great for people like me that don't have Like for people who have limited schedules and committing to a 40 to 60 minute race and having to worry about setups and all that stuff is like, it's not the best, right? Like it's tough to swing sometimes, but this series will stack perfectly with VRS. So you can just run GT3 nonstop. And I think the series is also every hour. So
it is not every hour. It's
no, it's
the VRS.
It's the opposite hours of VRS, right?
Taylor says, I think it will also weed out some riprap from VRS Open. I agree. That might be the best part of the whole deal, actually.
Yep.
Okay. Wow. I think that's all the release notes that we have.
I feel like GT3 fix ends up giving everyone what they want. That's at least the direction it seems to move things in. So, I don't know. We'll
okay,
see.
The last question I want to ask guys before we talk about RDP results and our experience. They call this, it says, look for the final version after the build is deployed. Do you think there's some secret content they haven't told us about? They've never done this before. They've never called it this before.
100%. And I have reasonable sources on what some of that content could be, but we'll see.
Oh, spicy. Let's see here. Hashtag ask the panel from Kev. Are there too many GT3 series? I don't think so.
No.
No.
That's I mean, fine. There's just, what, IMSA and VRS?
And yeah, it's just IMSA and VRS, and now this. That's fine.
And Ferrari fixed. Ferrari fixed.
Oh, yeah, D-Class.
That's fine.
IMSA, you know, if you want to race GT3 for fun, you've got two options. If you want to race GT3 at a really high level, that all tends to center around the VRS series.
Yep.
Yeah, IMSA is just lower level.
The VRS series is the worst series I have ever raced in. Every time.
It can't be worse than, like, Formula Fixed.
Formula Fixed is
I haven't done Formula Fixed.
Well, Formula Fixed used to be horrible, like when it was the F3 car for 15 minutes V6.
Yeah, but that was have you raced the USF 2000?
The USF 2000 is really fun, actually.
It's been good.
Okay. And the racing is surprisingly decent. Like, I've watched a couple decent softs, and it's pretty good.
When it was F3, though, when I was, like, starting the sim, oh my god, it was horrible.
Yeah, Taylor made in the chat, Rough can't possibly be sticking around too much longer, and I'll solve when it goes. The Rough GT3 is an incredibly fun car. I haven't gotten to race it very much, but I've enjoyed every time I've gotten to drive it. I think that we may see that car be sunset by the end of the year, but I guess time will tell.
Okay, let's go RTP, Brian.
RTP.
Okay, so you and I, well, we made a set, basically.
You
38.
No,
38 sets.
I think we made
it. You guys were going up in increments like 0.1 at a time, right? So 38 sets, roughly.
There was a lot of setage. But I got to say, we did that, I think, because on the Sunday before RTP, we were so unhappy with the set.
Mm-hmm.
Just the balance in particular, I think, is really what it came down to.
I guess as a brief aside, while Tom and Brian delve into the nitty-gritty of it, so the extent of my involvement in this was randomly being free two nights and coming to the spot for Blockwood. And then I get to listen to his delicious, delicious feedback on the set and racing experience. So
it's funny because I was really unhappy with the set on Sunday. But
yeah,
we got really tight, which was unexpected, you know, but by Thursday, I was actually pretty happy with the set on race day. I think, you know, it would have been a damn good weekly set, but we're not in a weekly series, you know?
Yeah.
So we got different levels here. But yeah, it was a lot of work. I do think still that 1.5s are probably my weakest setup of the main ovals that NASCAR stuff goes to. But so I was split 10. Brian, you were split 6. Is that right?
Seven.
Okay.
Almost 6. Only 4 cars from 6.
And so my race had an early caution.
I got him.
Early caution and went green the rest of the way. I think we had a caution on lap 7 or 11. Went green for the rest of the way. The early run, I dropped from P6 to P10-ish. And we sat there.
You started P6?
P9, I think.
Okay.
The quali field for Brian's split was maybe the most insane quali I've ever seen.
Yeah,
not what I expected in 6th split, to be honest. Or 7th split.
Well, Brian, I think I said P9, but at the caution, I was like P6, I want to say.
Gotcha.
But we dropped back a little bit in the shuffle, and after stops, we shuffled up, decided to stop as opposed to go as long as we could, so we just split the difference, and had a good run. I was really happy with the balance of the car when I was solo and drove to a P6. I think the leader cut a stop or something, however they saved fuel, whatever it worked out for them. And yeah, P6 in the split 10, and that put me at 107th or something overall in points, and you need top 70 to go to the round 2. So honestly, acceptable start. Wasn't ecstatic about the set, but particularly in the later runs when I could really settle down and focus on saving the right rear is good.
Yeah. Solid start anyway on a weak track. I think we learned a lot from it. I think we'll be stronger at Atlanta. I'd be surprised if we weren't.
I agree.
I think that we'd already have one car in the top 70 in points if someone had their chat unmuted while pit in was being called. But obviously no use crying over spilled milk. So,
well, also would have helped if a certain someone named Brian had their shit together on the setup and wasn't making major changes after the race session had already started.
You got to
fully tested that. Yeah. We actually found a really, really nice balance after the first stop, but the first run, which was full length, 45, 46 laps, the car was real tight. And I overdrove it too in traffic trying to make my way up.
I did too. And that's why I got loose. Yeah.
Yeah.
How was your first RTP experience, Brian? Was it enjoyable? I don't know. Like the week, just in general.
None of this is enjoyable, Tom.
Cut his mic. Cut his
you
mic.
Don't you don't try to qualify for pro because it's fun. That's stupid.
I actually really enjoy.
You just
my
do many race. Things where you jump from like 358 modifieds to Pro 2 light trucks and then jump into like a B fix.
I actually really enjoy my race. Gotta say.
Okay.
Looking back on it, though, I know, like, I think it takes a certain type of personality, but, like, I enjoyed grinding with Brian on the set, even when it wasn't going all that smoothly, like on Tuesday.
Yep.
It was looking back, I'm like, that was, it's a good grind.
Yeah, so, and I'd agree with that. What I'm saying is none of this was fun, but I enjoyed it. It felt like something worth doing. It was satisfying to, I've got a huge, huge learning curve on ovals in general, and especially the setups. What
I thought you were going to say, especially at Atlanta, but.
No, I think it's just that you're just a Atlanta Billy. As simple as that.
I thought he was going to say you're just a piece of shit, but hey.
I used to be really good at Michigan as well, but it's been a couple seasons since I ran it seriously, and I'm okay at Pocono.
Just hedging, so when I beat you, you have an excuse. That was good to see.
Goddamn right.
Brian, what was your final finishing position?
Oh, not good. It could have been like probably, I don't know, 15th or something. But we decided to just take our full 20 seconds of repairs that were slowing us down badly.
And it did make a significant difference over the course of that final run.
So oh, yeah. In the final run, I think our pace was relevant. I mean, we would have been in the pack from like second to fifth with that kind of pace.
Here's what I think. So I think that... I think we missed fundamentally in the cross and here's what I'll say. I think we fundamentally missed on getting the cross right, but considering that fact, the car was quite good. Had we not,
I think the car would have been just the cross.
No. But I think that was one of the fundamental issues with the car, I think.
Okay.
But a lot of learning in Vegas. Was an interesting race. The Progressive Banking, I think, made for good racing. And it looked, actually it did look a lot like the IRL race last night, if anyone watched it.
And it was weird. It was like there were two racing lines.
Dynamic Check's dead, that's impossible. Shut up. but that's Progressive Banking, man. It's not Dynamic Track. Jesus. Okay. I think that's it. BMW 120 tomorrow. That'll be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
A lot less time in that for me than RTP. But I really enjoy the BMW races, so we'll send it.
You want to know how many laps I've done at Vegas?
I'm going to guess 2,100.
I know mine.
That's pretty close, Manny. I don't think I'm quite a 2K. 1885.
I am 1748.
Nice. I'm going to be doing more, too, because I'm testing. I want to get the setup fundamentally right on Vegas. I want to know what we missed.
Yeah.
No, that's smart. I'm guessing you've just been using it to grind C opens for practice meanwhile and points.
No, actually, although maybe I should. I need to look at the SOFs. I might do one tonight. But
it's probably too late to do one tonight, but it might be worth a look tomorrow when people are actually on during the day.
Honestly,
I'd probably check the results for today.
I'm more worried about using the time for just testing, changing stuff.
Anything really, yeah.
Went wrong.
Yeah.
You know, clearly a pretty big gap in our truck versus the top trucks. So
yeah,
I think Tom, Tom mentioned part of the issue. I don't think that's the whole issue.
I don't either. I think the, even in split 10, there was I do think that had you put a top talent on the truck and not me, they might have won that race, even in our set. It would have been close. But I think it was obvious. So me to P3, not that far off, right? And they were quicker, but me to the top two, they clearly had something figured out with their driving and their set, and it was very, they were definitely better than the rest of the field, and that did not seem uncommon for the kind of split area that I was in from what I've heard. So, sometimes you get that. Sometimes you get some guys figure it out and go fast. Okay, Manny, Brian, do we have anything else?
Nope.
Oh, by the way, the memes throughout the episode was because a couple past drivers from a certain team, Redline.
I was gonna say from Team Blue Circle, but that works.
From a certain team.
They snuck into private sessions. Is that the way to describe it?
Yep.
Some pest drivers.
They exploited something on the web UI to access sessions that were not for them.
Without using the password, and I think that's a big distinction. They didn't ask a password or something. This was an actual unintended process.
I think I'm actually it's good meme content, but I'm kind of just sort of bummed about it because I don't know. It's just sort of sad. Sad event.
It is.
Well, I would. Sad for who though?
The series. Everyone.
Esports.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's. I mean, it's a bad look for the series. It's a super bad look for the team with the three drivers who have now been effectively banned at T23, and I believe that includes a race winner from Besk as well. Pretty shit look. And the team's already been shrouded in a bit of controversy ever since last year, and the big VRS PDS setup drama. And then them borrowing setups and building off of them to sell for profit from people coming into their coaching sessions. So people were paying to have their setup stolen. It was just not a good look for anyone involved.
Yeah, we don't need Brian to comment on it. I know Brian's a little bit closer to this little pest deal, but I think it's just sort of a drag that we
have.
No,
I do want to comment on it.
Okay. Oh, please do.
I agree that it's sad, but I think it's a pretty good indicator of the state that esports is in right now. And I don't know if it's this way across all titles. I'm sure it's this way across sim racing. I'm not sure if it's this way in top level esports like League of Legends, Dota, that sort of thing, Counter-Strike. I mean, I know there's plenty of toxicity going around there as well, and people getting banned for hacking every so often, all kinds of just ridiculous shit. But in our little world of sim racing, I don't know. It's just, I don't see how it's ever worth it to do something like that, to damage your reputation, to even risk damaging your reputation for a game like that. And I think a lot of people...
And it's a pretty small community, and they all know each other.
Yeah. I think a lot of people, myself included at one point, place a little bit too high of a... maybe not priority, but importance on what driving in the Super Cup actually means. I mean, what do we have? From prize money, maybe five people in iRacing are making enough prize money to support themselves. Obviously, the stuff that's analogous, like coaching, data packs, that's supporting a lot more people. But point is, this doesn't necessarily matter as much as a lot of the drivers think it does.
Yeah.
And I think it's just, it causes this rift. I mean, it makes the competition toxic. Everybody's trying to get a little bit too much, which may be understandable if it's, you know, career impacting. But at this point, it's really not. Like, the career opportunities are either moving into real life racing somehow, which few people have managed to do, or building something outside of actually driving fast. And for the people that have managed to make the career out of just driving fast, that's the main thing, you know, totally understand that's the way to go about this, right? This is ultra important. This is what matters. For 37 out of the 40 drivers in the field, it's not like that.
I thought that was great, Brian, and well said. I do think that sometimes, I know that it's a lot of young guys at the top of the sport, either in Coke or Pask. And I don't think sometimes they consider how for people that, like you said, are strictly making a career or making money on going fast, how much value there is for them in making the show good.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So like if you are top 10 in PESC this year, and the next year, and the next year, and you might want to be top five or win it someday, the show being good in any way that you can support it, any way,
mm-hmm.
has crazy value on your career.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that's how we get from 3-4 people being supported to the whole field being supported.
Yeah, right.
To, you know, right. Real esport. Level.
Right, exactly. And I'm not saying we have to go WWE, you know. Okay.
No, of course not.
But
of course not. But stuff like this is just taking it too far.
Yeah.
And personally, yeah, you know, this is pretty. What I just said basically describes my view on the whole tire warming thing. Although that's much less of an extreme example.
And you do have a pole award named after you now, so was it really not worth it?
That's not named after me. I've just won it the most times.
I think it's in the same vein, although it's much less... what's the word I'm looking for?
I think they're both indicators of the same
thing. Insidious?
Yes, Manny. Yeah, something like that. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but yeah, no, it is the state that we're in, and... everyone has to push really hard, and it's kind of cutthroat.
I think we can probably just summarize this as cheating bad, vroom vroom good.
Cheating definitely bad.
Yeah,
and vroom vroom is pretty good.
Yeah, have to agree.
I do think that, man, I have a hard time seeing how anyone would think cheating would help their career long term. I really do.
I don't think
There is a long and storied history of that in both virtual and real life sport. So that's maybe more meta than we probably have time for today. But
I know. One last thing. But I do think that in real sport, Manny, that you can win enough money in 2 years to support your life. And you can't do that in esports, in sim racing.
So in sim racing, maybe. In esports, yes. But in sim racing, maybe.
Yeah, so, but I'm just saying is, like, if you're Lance Armstrong and you cheat, you're made.
Yeah.
If you cheat in PESC 2 years, you're not.
It's as you said, Tom, or you hit on it a second ago. The field is mostly kids, you know.
Yeah, in the end, yeah.
Kids, maybe a lot of us are early 20s. But for the most part, you know, we're talking people with no perspective or very little perspective, very little life experience. There are some exceptions. I'm not talking about everybody in the field. But a large enough chunk just aren't really seeing this, aren't thinking long term. And I think that's, if not the root of the problem, at least part of it.
Sure. I think that's a good ender. I mean, I think, you know, we'll just end on that downer. Real here for SR downer. Hashtag.
That's why I'm here.
Bring you down. No, I think the whole thing is a downer, but I do think it's good.
How do we summarize that conversation? Hashtag God is dead. That's probably the vibe I got going right now.
Anyway, I hope for the best in the future of the series and sim racing in general. So
he can get there. In parentheses,
Manny, I need you to do the.
No.
Okay.
So what we're actually going to do with that is, I'm gonna need you to go back and clip it to a soundboard that we can just press for
the
future.
Okay, that'd be good. So Nick can just do it from the grave. This has been Here for SR, a podcast about iRacing, iRacing memes and the people who make them, and also stealing sets.
Also, how every wreck,
financial information.
Oh
stealing.
Yes, yeah. Every wreck is your fault.
And how every wreck is your fault. Thank
that's
you.
Right. I've been Tom Ramitas. That's Manny Tolentino. No, wrong way. That's Moni Tolentino. That's Brian Lockwood.
You're doing a great job for the audio only listeners.
You. I'm pointing.
You know how you bitch at me for this all the time. I just want to point out you sucked at this.
You can find us on Twitch. You can find us on here, the number 4sr.com. The new Billy School is up and running, or as I like to call it, Here for SR Driver Development. Is that better?
It's Billy School, but yeah.
Billy School it is. Which is the coaching and moral support service. Let's see. Is there anything else we have on? Merch is at Apex Hunters United. Look for the Here for SR collection. I think that's it. We are on YouTube. You can find this podcast on Spotify, any of the other
major podcasting platforms.
Anything you could find. We are out of here. We will be seeing you after we download the update with secret content. Okay.
Bye.
Bye.